Soothsayers, soothsayers, all kinds of wise men. But God let him have a dream one night which portrayed the whole dispensation of the time of the Gentiles. Nebuchadnezzar, when he woke up, he became so troubled by his dream. He asked all of his counselors and soothsayers and wise men and astronomers and astrologers, just like the world is today. They've got degrees. But when he asked them concerning the dream, they said, well, tell us the dream and we will tell you the matter. The dream was taken from him. He knew he had seen a terrible picture or something of it. But Daniel, a young man, a Jew, when the wise men and all of those were threatened to be killed, this would put Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and so forth right in the same group. Nebuchadnezzar would go to clean house. But God so let Nebuchadnezzar have that dream in order to bring about the occasion for Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to pray. And God showed Daniel the dream and the interpretation. When he asked the captain of the guard to take him before Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel told him the dream, what he had dreamed, and told him the interpretation. And what he did, Nebuchadnezzar just worshipped the God of Daniel. But he actually just prostrated himself and was going to worship Daniel. That in itself is how Daniel was elevated to the position that he held during the whole period of Nebuchadnezzar, Belteshazzar, and evil Merodach, which was the third one in line of the Babylonian Empire. Now we're in the latter years of the Babylonian Empire. We're now looking at something other during the time of the Medes and the Persians are going to get ready to come on the scene. Daniel is very much concerned about how much longer is his people going to have to stay in captivity. Now we're going to read the first two verses of the ninth chapter of Daniel. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of the years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. Now we get our historical background. The point I'm reading this is, Jesus says in Matthew 24, concerning the time leading up to the end, and to the time of the great tribulation, and the abomination that maketh desolate, standing in the holy place, Jesus said, whosoever readeth, let him understand. Now that tells me, brothers and sisters, that there's to be a generation of people, Christ-believing disciples, that it's going to fall in their responsibility that as we near the ending of time, somewhere there's got to be a people begin to become concerned. How close are we to the coming of Jesus Christ? We have many things already in existence in the world right now that proves we're in the last day. Did not Jesus say, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be? We're living in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. It used to be, brothers and sisters, that this perverted way of life in America was evilly talked about. But today, if you say anything about it in public place, you are condemned already. You're an anti-racist, you're an anti-sexist, you're a this or a that. Our modern philosophy today is that a democracy can be a place politically free enough that all lifestyles, all kinds of social cultures, all kind of political ideas, all kind of economical conditions can coexist in a democracy. You're a fool to believe that. You are. It's a sick bureaucracy. Now, we've got Sodom and Gomorrah in existence. And the sad part of it is, they want it that way. In fact, they want you to believe it's a normal sin. It's a sign of the judgment of God. Now, Daniel is starting his fasting and praying. If Daniel is going to be concerned about the outcome of his people, the future of Jerusalem, and when's this terrible dispersion of the Jews going to be over, he set about reading books also. Turn back with me to Jeremiah. In Jeremiah, the 25th chapter, is a prophecy spoken by Jeremiah shortly before the Babylonian Empire came on her great invasion plans for world domination, and which would begin the time Jesus refers to in Luke 21, that Jerusalem would be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. We're going to read the Jeremiah prophecy that started those things that Jesus said. It was a prophecy at the time Jeremiah spoke it. We're in the 9th verse in the 25th chapter of Jeremiah. These are the words Daniel was reading when he started fasting and seeking his God concerning what was ahead when we read our text. Behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, saith the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant. The king of Babylon, my servant, and will bring them against this land, meaning the land of Israel, and against the inhabitants thereof, and against all these nations round about, and will utterly destroy them, and make them an astonishment, and an hissing, and perpetual desolation. Moreover, I will take from them the voice of mirth, and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, and the voice of the bride, the sound of the millstone, that's industry, and the light of the candle. And this whole land shall be a desolation, and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. That prophecy came 607 B.C. There was really 3 invasions by the Babylonian Empire. But we must understand, the beginning of these invasions was God's way of slowly showing mercy at the same time, yet he was ministering judgment. Because Jeremiah prophesied through all these invasions. When the king of Babylon came the first time, the degree of suffering wasn't quite as bad. The city was spared. They were just invaded and many taken back to Babylon captivity. But to cut that part of it short, because God said Jerusalem would become a heap of rubbish and so forth, then the last time King Nebuchadnezzar's army came, they literally demolished the city, tore the temple down, sacked the city for everything of a value, took all the royal seed back to Babylon. Daniel, Ezekiel, and all of them were now in Babylon captivity. Time has elapsed. 7 years. This finds us sitting, as we read that in Daniel chapter 9, as he said about the reading the books, determining the number of years that they were to be there. We realize that in this same period of time, there was a young Persian prince by the name of Cyrus, that had been prophesied that he would make a decree that would release the Jews, and they would then be permitted to go back and build the temple. Now, the reason I bring this in, the study of the 70 weeks of Daniel, you do not begin it with Cyrus's decree to release the Jews from Babylon captivity and to go back to build the temple. That was accomplished in 535, I believe it is, B.C. The 70 weeks of Daniel is altogether a different study. It's tied to the building of the walls, cleaning up the streets, reconstructing the city, making it a fit, inhabitable place for the Jews themselves, and a process of time would go on for all of this to be accomplished somewhere within the final period of that. The Messiah, the Jews' long-awaited king-to-be, would come on the scene. So now then, having read that, turn with me now to where the angel of the Lord begins to give him this yardstick. Now, what we're going to read here, I want you to understand, it's written around 538. Now, the reason I give you these approximate dates, what is told by the angel to Daniel at that time is a prophecy. In relation to a prophecy that Daniel has read. In other words, it's a furtherance of what Daniel has been studying about. But we do know Daniel, as he sought the Lord, then it was not long till Cyrus came on the scene and gave the decree, the release of the Jews that wanted to go out of a free will, wanting to choose to go back and build their temple, they could go. He even afforded so much money out of the Persian treasury to accomplish the job. You can read that in the prophets of Zechariah and Haggai. Now, Daniel never did return to Jerusalem. He stayed in the Persian palace. Now then, we're going to begin reading here now. In verse 23 of the ninth chapter, because the angel now definitely comes and speaks to Daniel concerning his prayer, what he's seeking. The angel is talking to Daniel these words: at the beginning of thy supplication, meaning prayer, the commandment came forth that I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore understand the matter, or the subject, and consider the vision, because what Daniel was seeing, which later become written, was definitely a vision in which the angel communicated these words. The angel tells Daniel, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. Thy people is speaking of the Jews, who were still in exile at the time. But it wouldn't be long till Cyrus would make a decree for the release of those that want to go back to build the temple. Listen to what I'm saying, and don't get ahead of my thought. But when we break this down, we've got to understand the 70 weeks did not start with Cyrus's decree. The 70 weeks that we're going to study starts with a decree made years later in 445 B.C., and we will read it in the book of Nehemiah. So now we will continue on. The people is the Jew, and upon thy holy city, which is Jerusalem, because they've been away from it for 70 years, to finish the transgression. This is describing the overall rebellious attitude that the Jewish nation had lived, showing their displeasure, their carelessness, and sinful ways, which led up to the Babylonian invasion. And to make an end of sins, this is talking about the sins of the people, and to make a reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision, meaning complete, fulfill the prophecy, and to anoint the Most Holy. It's not talking about anointing a king. It's about the anointed king already being anointed. He's anointed in heaven. But when he steps in that new rebuilt temple, that's prophesied also in Revelation chapter 11, then that's the holy place, brothers and sisters. It is anointed by the presence of the King of Glory himself sitting in it. Now, when we go to verse 25, the angel begins to break this 70 weeks down into different categories. And we will take that in consideration in a few minutes. We want to get the scriptures in our mind and place just right. First off, we're looking at a symbolic description of time. When the angel said 70 weeks, he did not mean 70 weeks of 7 days each. We're living under the Roman calendar, but since we've divided the months up into periods of four approximately, it comes from a Greek word, which means seven. If you notice back, brothers and sisters, in the B.C. period of the Bible, in the chronology of the Israelites' history, like in Kings and Chronicles, they never referred to a week. They always said the first day of the month, second day of the month, 15th day of the month, 21st day of the month. Amen. Never a week. A week was only in reference. After the Grecian Empire really did affect the Middle East and the land of Israel, it was then that time begins to be grouped into, we will say, times of seven. How many understands my illustration? And that's where the week come in. And that's why we get in the New Testament. Because they're living under Roman time. And so on the first day of the week, Mary came to the tomb, you know, to do such and such after the burial of Jesus. So now, when we go back now, the angel is actually telling Daniel 70 weeks of years are determined upon thy people, the Jews, and upon thy city. Therefore, if it is 70 weeks of years, then it means God has chosen that these years of time will be so bringing out details in relationship to the Jewish people and the city of Jerusalem that he puts it in here as a prophecy to be understood later by those that have a spiritual mind and a yearning to want to know where they are in time. Keep in mind, there were some Jews longing and looking for the promise of the Messiah. Amen. There's some Gentile Christians today that's looking for the coming of Jesus Christ to be the bridegroom. But there was multitudes of Jews, Pharisees, that cared less whether their Messiah come or not. They was caught up in their money problems and such like. That's just like the Gentile church world today. There's people today going to church. They're no more concerned about when Jesus comes and nothing to worry. They're out for everything that this life has to offer for them. Now, the reason I'm approaching it in this manner, Jesus is coming. Amen. Whether begging or any of the rest are ready. He's coming whether I'm even ready or not. he's coming, not when some professor gets it all figured out. He's coming right on schedule. And it's up for you and I, brothers and sisters, to have a spiritual eye and an ear to begin to associate time, world conditions, in respects to what has already been fulfilled in ancient times. That gives us our base. How to look ahead. Now, we're going to read the 70 weeks, how the angel broke it down, and then we will turn to the map. The angel speaks to Daniel very specifically. He said, "Know, therefore." Now, when this prophecy starts in 445, Daniel is nowhere left alive. But the Jewish people that was still in Babylon would definitely know, because the prophecy lives on. That's what we've got to look at. "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment." Now, the commandment means there's going to be a specific commandment in time somewhere that determines the beginning of this. "To restore." Now notice what it says to do. "To restore and to build Jerusalem." It says not one thing about the temple, does it? No. Because by the time this prophecy goes in effect, the temple will have already been rebuilt under the prophetic ministry of Zechariah and Haggai. Back in 500 and something. Alright. "To restore and to build the city," and that's Jerusalem, "unto the Messiah." Now the reason it's worded like that means the city must be rebuilt before their Messiah can come. Meaning, he won't come and stand watching it be rebuilt. Now, the reason I say it that way, it's the same way when we look at Revelation 11. Some people's got the idea that the temple will not be rebuilt till after Jesus is back here. Forget it. Jesus will not be standing around with his arms folded, waiting for them to build the temple for him to get in. It'll already be built. Now then, "unto the Messiah the Prince," now notice this is capital letters, "shall be 7 weeks, and," is a conjunction, "threescore and 2 weeks," which means 62 weeks. And we're talking about 62 series of 7 years in each series. "The street," it's true that the street is mentioned in the singular, but keep in mind, it means that the city will be completely cleaned up. All the streets will be re-cleaned, houses rebuilt, and finally the walls will eventually reach their final built state, the way they're supposed to be. "And the wall, even in troublous times." And notice as I've read that, not one thing has been said about the temple, has it? Because brothers and sisters, you go back under Zechariah and Haggai and you read there how the temple was built back there just after the 5th century B.C. Now then, I would like for you to turn with me this morning here. And this is just kind of a crude chart, but we've got three red lines. Now the top line, brothers and sisters, is dealing with a year mentioned in Nehemiah, 445. And when we're talking about 445, we're looking at years before Christ, and this point right here, this line right here, marks the line that separates B.C. from A.D. Now, a lot of people, brothers and sisters, don't even realize what B.C. and A.D., what it actually does. B.C. means before the Christian era. which is all determined by this mark, 0.0, and that is gauged by the death of King Herod that you'll find written in the Gospel. Now then, when we think of the birth of Christ and A.D., thinking of the Advent, it's not even related to that necessarily. It don't mean after death. It's referring to the advent of the Christian era. And I'm going to read from Jewish history in a little bit. Now, the advent of Christ, and since this part right here, brothers and sisters, according to the Roman calendar, everything has been determined in reference to the advent of Christ or the Christian era. The world before Christ did not have a universal calendar. But the Western world and the Middle East, especially the Jews and those, have went by the Julian or the Roman calendar. It has become an accepted universal means of measuring time. That don't make the Far East. China doesn't. Japan doesn't. Vietnam doesn't. Korea doesn't. They got their own calendar. But the Western world has accepted the Julian or the Roman calendar, and the Jews speak of it. They call it the Christian era, CE. Now, we do know this, according to the Gospel of the birth of Christ. Jesus was born before King Herod's death. Let's get that established. How many realize that? A lot of people go to church today, they don't even want him born in respects to B.C. or A.D. And I realize it's confusing. But I realize this morning, if we don't begin to get a little bit of a profile of this in our mind, then one of these days this world is going to tumble into a period of time, and then you're going to begin to hear people say, hey, do you think it could be the end time? I'm scared. Well, it's time for somebody to get scared. Because the conditions leading up to this is already out there. Now, I want to establish this point once again. That line is gauged by Jewish history, which refers to B.C. time. It terminates with the death of King Herod. Because most all nations in B.C. time wrote their histories based on the reign of their individual kings. Even the Jews did. I can read to you from Kings and Chronicles. Even Israel wrote their measurement of time down in the year of King Josiah, in the year of Jeroboam, in the year of such and such. And they will tell you right there in the Kings and Chronicles how many years each king reigned. How many realize that? They had no universal calendar. So then, on this side, in the Advent period of Christ, or the Christian era, the Western world, one, it began to be influenced by the measurement of time. They automatically began to accept a universal calendar for the Western nation, especially where Christianity was embraced. Therefore, they have to then go back and correlate certain B.C. histories to make it blend in with Julian coming forth on this side of the king of death, the death of King Herod. So you can, in your mind, you can mark B.C. stops with the death of King Herod as you read about in the Gospel. Also, we are living here now in December. The world that is Catholic to the core. It comes from old pagan Rome. They celebrate the birth of Christ. But we can see what the modern world has done. They don't even want Christ in it no more. So they're left with what? A hollow shell of a day of ceremony and has no meaning whatsoever. It goes to show the devil has made a fool out of the world. Just a time, brothers and sisters. People go in debt, spend a lot of money, go out here and buy a lot of junk, and born sometime in the fall of the solar year, whatever year that was. In Matthew and in Luke's account, when you put the two together, and you really get the birth of Christ, Jesus was born somewhere back here, maybe a year or a year and a half, prior to the death of King Herod. And keep in mind, King Herod was not a king appointed by the Jews. King Herod was a king appointed by the Roman emperors. When the Jews were taken in captivity back to Babylon in 600 and something B.C., Zedekiah was the last king of the royal seed line that the Jews ever had. And it was prophesied by Ezekiel that Israel would never have another king until he whose right it is would come, and he would take the throne of David and would set upon it, brothers and sisters. And from there on, Israel would have the king that all their previous BC kings typed and set forth through that of King David and King Solomon. Therefore, King Herod's death was just the death of a Roman appointed king. And that point is zero as far as BC time and AD time. But the birth of Christ actually occurs right here somewhere. Now then, this line right here, starting from this point over to this point right here, this breaks down the two first periods of the 70 weeks of Daniel. This line right here, starting from this point over to this point right here, that gives us the number of prophetic years. As we break solar time down, the calendar time, 365 and one-fourth days. Now then, let me finish reading, and then we're going to start breaking this down and describing from the history what each period exemplifies in relationship to the prophecy, what goes on, and how we recognize it, so forth. Notice here it says, to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, get it ready, shall be 7 weeks. Now, what does 7 weeks mean, since we're not talking about weeks of days? We're talking about weeks, or seven-year periods. There's going to be seven-year periods. Something's definitely going to be accomplished. All right? So that's why we got this little line like this. 49 prophetic years. Alright? That will bring us, brothers and sisters, to the time of Ezra and Malachi. And first off, brothers and sisters, we want to see how the decree came for all of this to start. Turn with me back to the book of Nehemiah. He was the prophet. And we're in the first chapter. I'm just going to refer to the chapter. I won't read from it. But I will read from the second chapter. So as we go to the first chapter of Nehemiah, Nehemiah, a Jew, is still in Persia. The year is approximately around 446 to 445. Some young men have came back from Jerusalem to pay a visit, we will say, and Nehemiah has asked these men, what is the state, the condition of the city of Jerusalem? He was very concerned about it. And they told him how the walls were still a shambles, the gates were burned, the streets was just topsy-turvy, and everything looked amiss. Well, this made Nehemiah feel so bad. So now we pick up our reading in the beginning verse of the second chapter. And it came to pass in the month Nisan. This word describes the Jewish month that begins approximately around, we will say, the 15th, 16th, it fluctuates backwards and forwards, 21st of March, and carries on through April. It does not correspond to the full month of March, nor the full month of April. It corresponds about the middle of it. In the 12th year of Artaxerxes, the king, that wine was before him, and I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. He's sad because what he heard, how Jerusalem and everything looked. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad, when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said unto the king, if it please the king, and if thy servant hath found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my fathers, sepulchres, that I may build it. And the king said unto me, the queen also sitting by him, for how long shall thy journey be? And when wilt thou return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. Moreover, I said unto the king, if it please the king, let letters be given me to the governors beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come unto Judah. Now, when he said beyond the river, meaning crossing the Euphrates, which had been for centuries a great boundary between the Middle East and everything east of that, that they may convey me over till I come unto Judah. And a letter unto Asp, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the palace, which appertain to the house, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall enter into. And the king granted me according to the good hand of my God upon me. Then I came to the governors beyond the river, and gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me. Now verse 10, let's look at this setting. Because brothers and sisters, in this verse 10, we sort of get a little type of what exists against the Jews in the land today. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite. Now the Ammonite is none other than the people of the country of Jordan today, which King Hussein is king over them. Heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. In other words, no sooner did he get back there and word spread out, he has come to do something or other. Here came old Sanballat and old Tobiah, Arabs, to begin to make a hindrance. And if that hasn't been a condition, brothers and sisters, only on a larger scale. Now, the point is, a letter has been given Nehemiah to start this prophecy that we read in Daniel. In the month of Nisan, in the year 445, solar calendar time, B.C., calendar time, you don't break it down yet in the prophetic year. The month of Nisan, Nehemiah had this decree. And brothers and sisters, he starts. Now the reason the angel broke this down, that as this starts, he said, in 7 weeks after the commandment starts, that means 49 years, there's going to be a specific time transpired when certain things will be done. When you read them, what Nehemiah did after he came back there, and they started, to build the city. They build the walls. They had to build the walls first and the gates, because they knew it would do no good to clean up the city and people come in to build houses if you're not going to have walls of protection to protect the people. So therefore, the walls were first, the gates, and that was set about. Now, to show on what this does, these 49 years are to definitely be broken down into prophetic years of time. These prophetic years of time, when you get them broke down, as this starts in 445 B.C., the writings of Malachi is recorded to be 397 B.C. When that 49 years of time have elapsed, it's true, the walls have been built, the gates have been built, Ezra had come on the scene, there's been a great revival. People for a little short period have returned to the Lord. You read Ezra and see the revival ahead. How people wept, the law was discovered, Ezra stood on a platform, and therefore they had a revival as the city, the walls and the gates and everything. But what marks, we will say, the ending of that is when we turn to Malachi. So turn there with me this morning. And I realize, brothers and sisters, I'm reading to you a lot of prophecy. Malachi comes on the scene in the first two chapters. What does he do? He's coming on the scene just at the ending of this, you might say, this period right here. He finds that at the end of 49-year period, the people have slumped into an apostate condition. It's true, the temple's been built for quite some time. The walls have too, the gates have too, but the people are cheating God. They're bringing their lame, their sick, their blemished animals for sacrifice. You read that in the first chapter. God, through the prophet Malachi, rebukes them. That's why I'm not going to read it. You read it yourself. But the main thing that stands out is these first two chapters deals with God rebuking the Jews that have come back in that period of time. They built the walls. They built the gates. They've done that much. They've had a revival under Ezra, the prophet, who was the priest. And now the revival has cooled off, and the people have slumped right back into cold-dead formalism. And instead of bringing their best to the temple, such as their unblemished animals, you read it right here, they're offering polluted bread, old stale bread. They're bringing in the halt, the lame, all kinds of blemished animals. And God looks upon that, and he frowns. Therefore, brothers and sisters, when you read chapter 3, you get another prophecy, what God then is going to do somewhere as this period of time continues on, comes down here, and we find it's concerning John the Baptist. And then the rest of chapter 3 goes ahead and shows how God rebukes those Jews in that closing period there, because he knows that that apostate period is going to determine what happens as the Jews and their descendants will begin to travel by time down through these 434 years, or these 62 weeks, which are prophetic years of time. Brothers and sisters, going to be a time of troubles that the city itself is built. Now then, let's go back and read in Daniel. We've got the 7 weeks. That's 49 years. And we can see more or less where it more or less terminates its purpose and objective, but what has come about. Now we read the 62 weeks. And 62 weeks, the street, you can read it like this, the streets shall be built again, and the wall, even in pro- troublous times. Now the next, brothers and sisters, in Jewish history, 397 is the approximate date they give Malachi. But the Jews in history, they call it for the next 400 years of this time right here, was one of the darkest periods of that period of time right there, and it shows how much trouble went on. Turn with me, brothers and sisters, back into the eighth chapter. In my mind here, I've got so many scriptures and things, and I want to get everything just lined out right, so that people listening to this on the video, and I don't want to say something other that would confuse them, but I never, nevertheless, in my mind, I've got a lot of dates and scriptures and such like. Now, to describe this 62 weeks and to give you a scriptural account how evil it was, how troublous it was, it tells me in Jewish history that the high priest, that the Jews came back when they built their temple, the man that fell in line was a man by the name of Joshua. You read about that in Zechariah and in Haggai. After the death of Joshua, his son was appointed as high priest. And from then on, brothers and sisters, the high priests were men. They were like our politicians. They assassinated. They bought that rank, that position from the governors, because keep in mind, once the king of Babylon invaded Jerusalem, Jerusalem, brothers and sisters, was always left to be a city oppressed by outside Gentile influence. Therefore, no matter what period the Jew lived in, he was always living under the lordship of a Gentile power. First Babylon, then the Medes and Persians, and then the Greeks. So we're going to come into the period of the Greeks, because in 325, brothers and sisters, B.C., that's when the Greeks takes over the whole Middle East world in full power. It was the Persians up about that time. All right? But each one of these lordships over the Jews, this high priest office was bought. It was this corruption, this political corruption, that went on in the high priest religious circle. Because the high priest was the highest official the Jewish people had to represent them, between them and the Gentile Lord, whoever he might be. Therefore, this man used this position for political gain. And brother, the corruption that went on, and many times the betrayal, and the betrayals, how these high priests used their influence, brought untold suffering to the Jewish people. All right? I'm going to read a little sketch here from the Bible prophecy, how the angel had told Daniel a part of this period of time would be likened to. And then I'm going to take you to a page of history that describes it. And the reason I say this morning, if Jesus said, "Whosoever readeth, let him understand," what are we going to read today? We're not only going to read the Bible prophecy itself, but we're going to have in accessibility the histories written by truly mortal men, but related to the conditions of time that affects those prophets, because those things have done been fulfilled. Now then, if we can understand how certain periods of this time has already been fulfilled, this helps us better to understand when that last week of time, which is coming up somewhere right in front of us. As I read here this morning from Daniel chapter 8, it speaks of a little horn. It's talking about the Grecian Empire. Therefore, the 8th verse, to get the setting. Therefore the he-goat waxed very straight, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken. Now that is in reference to Alexander the Great, the one that founded the Grecian Empire. And the great horn was broken, and for it, meaning in the place of it, came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. This, according to history, I have it right there. It is written, the four notable ones was his four army generals that had fought with him in the great campaigns that eventually brought the whole prophetic world under Alexander the Great's control. When he died, there was no king left to take command. So the four generals divided the vast dominion into four different territories, each general being a lord over them. Now we're looking toward that area which is identified as Syria. Syria, how it's related to the land of Israel. And out of one of them came forth a little horn. This is out of the Syrian makeup, which waxed exceedingly great toward the south and toward the east and toward the pleasant land. The word pleasant land means the holy land or the Jewish land. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven. And it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamped upon it. Meaning, all of this is symbolic of what this little horn was going to do against the Jewish people, specifically. Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away. Now, the reason we've got to understand why this is mentioned like this, and why it stands out so vividly, because we're dealing, brothers and sisters, in the period of time of the Grecian period, which is right along about here. And the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. This is all descriptive of what it says in the histories, what Antiochus Epiphanes, the Syrian prince, did to the Jewish people. Now, and a host was given him, meaning God allowed a certain element of the Jewish people to be given to him for brutal judgment against the daily sacrifice by reason of transgression, and it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced and prospered. Then I heard one saint speaking, and another saint said unto that certain saint which spake, how long shall be the vision concerning the daily sacrifice and the transgression of desolation? Now notice, the reason this is described this way at this time in prophecy is because God is going to use this, what this little horn does, to set a type of what the actual Antichrist will do in the 70th week of Daniel when it comes up and it's right in front of us. Here's the type. It shows his attitude, what he purposed to do against the Jews and against the temple, and here it's all characterized. Concerning the transgression of desolation, to give both the sanctuary and the host to be trodden underfoot. And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Now it is 10 minutes to 12 o'clock. As I said, that portion of prophecy which covers the latter years of the Grecian Empire. God allowed one prince out of the Syrian realm of the breakup of the Roman, of the Grecian Empire, to stand out as a type to start this time of desolation in type only. No, Antiochus was not the Antichrist, he was not the beast, but he stood as a type, the beginning, and he characterized all of it. So allow me to read to you, brothers and sisters, a little bit of what history says. Because if I get up here and said, well, that's what this means, but I don't have some history to back it up, somebody could come along and say, well, that's not what that means. So I'm going to read to you just a little bit of what history says. And I grant you, brothers and sisters, some people, history is just as boring to them as math was to me. So I'm not reading it to really give you facts of history related to Bible prophecy and how it fits precisely the picture. Now, the histories I use, I don't like to use these modern ones, but most of our world historians today, they're guilty of doing certain things. First off, some of them they tried to paint over a bad picture somewhere in times gone by. Because if there are certain religious things they kind of want to cover up and plaster up, well, they sure got a good way of doing it. But this history I got here is written in 1835. The book is 152 years old. It was written by men, brothers and sisters, that really believe what they did in their time. I'm going to read to you about Antiochus Epiphanes, the little horn of the Grecian Empire. The successor of Seleucus in the Syrian monarchy was Antiochus Epiphanes. He took the throne 175 B.C. And to show you how these historians, they relate history to what the Bible says. The prophet Daniel predicted that he should be a vile person. Such he proved himself by all of his private and public conduct. The first of his acts which seriously affected the Jews was his selling the high priest. That's why I said a while ago, selling the high priest. And really, that's what went on down through there. And that's why the prophecy of Daniel, how that eventually the streets and the city and the wall would be built. It would eventually reach that finished purpose of God. But it would all come about through a long period of troubles brought on by betrayal, crookedness. So, as he does this, he sold the priesthood to Jason, brother to Onias, the reigning high priest, for 360 talents. Now I'm going to pick up Jason here. Jason, however, enjoyed his power but a short period. After a reign of 3 years, he was supplanted by Manlius, his brother, a greater monster in wickedness than himself, B.C. 174. Such men sought the office first because it was hereditary in their family, but chiefly because it now embraced the temporal government of Jerusalem. Manlius publicly apostatized the religion of the Greeks and drew as many as possible in his influence. He sold the sacred vessels from the sanctuary to pay the enormous sum of 300 talents by which he had supplanted his brother. In other words, he bought it, see, and therefore his brother was kicked out. And caused Onias, who had reproved him for his sacrilege, to be put to death. But some virtue remained with the people, for they resented this sacrilege. Now I'm going to try to break this thing down here, brothers and sisters, but I want to put enough on the tape so people will know I'm not trying to interpret this to fit my own ideas. I want history to speak for itself. This is to show the troublous times and how this prophecy, how long that desolation was to last. When you actually take this prophecy here, 2,300 days, it's just a little bit over 6 years that was to last. And this is written right here in the history. So if you'll just bear with me now, brothers and sisters, I want to show you something other than that. There came about then a period where this Antiochus Epiphanes, he became so evil, he was on a campaign into Egypt. Certain other Jews, they was wanting to get free from his power. Well, somebody cooked up the scheme that Antiochus had got killed in Egypt. And that word reached back, well, then there was an open revolt by the Jews. And as it was, they was going to clean up the temple and everything. But it so happened that when Epiphanes down in Egypt heard of this, he come back through there. And if I can catch the point right here where this happened, well, I will try to read. But the Jews had a false report of his death, and Jason immediately marched into the city with 1,000 men to avenge himself on Menelaus. Antiochus, hearing of this and of the rejoicing in Jerusalem, supposed that the whole city and nation had revolted from him, hastily marched into Jerusalem, put to death 40,000 persons, and sold an equal number for slaves. He broke into the Holy of Holies, robbed the temple of the altar of incense, the shewbread table, and the candlesticks of seven branches, which were all of gold, the recent gifts of friendly monarchs. And to show his contempt and hatred of the Jewish religion, he sacrificed a hog upon the altar of burnt offering. He made Philip, a man of ferocious spirit, governor of Judah, and restored Menelaus to the high priesthood. Jason died a miserable vagabond in about 2 years. Now, I could go ahead and give you some more of that report, but I think I've read enough right there, brothers and sisters. You turn back now then to the map. This 62 weeks, as it truly did, all the world histories bear out what the Jews suffered from this time on down to here. When we come closer to this, out of that period there of what Antiochus Epiphanes did, rose the Maccabean brothers, who finally overthrew the reign of him. They conquered at the end of that allotted desolation period. They cleansed the temple after it had went through that period, and they restored worship, put down all the idols that the Syrian monarch had set up. And then that closed then, the period in for another period of time. And as that period closed out, we're coming down then to the beginning of the Roman Empire finally. Now then, let's deal with the prophetic here part. 7 weeks here, 62 weeks from here to the death of Christ. Notice in this, that prophet, it doesn't tell you when Christ was born, does it? It just says, at the end of 62 weeks, the Messiah, the Prince, shall be cut off. Now, the thing is, we have to understand this. If he's going to be cut off, that means his death. But when we know from the New Testament what his approximate age was, Jesus was approximately 33 and a half years of age when he was crucified. You say, how do you arrive at that, Brother Jackson? All because the Bible tells us in Luke chapter 3 that Jesus was baptized beginning to be about 30 years of age. Right? That's Luke. All right. But according to secular history, he was baptized in the fall of the year. And you can see it in the gospel. If he was baptized in the fall of the year, then it means when he was baptized, it was 40 days. He was in the wilderness fasting and praying. After that, he returns out and goes back to Nazareth, where he was raised up from boyhood. Then with his mother and his disciples, he goes to Cana of Galilee. That was the beginning of his miracle. In that first 6 months, he not only ministers in and around Cana of Galilee, but down around the Sea of Galilee. Now, the reason I bring that all in, that's in the first 6 months of his ministry, from Paul to the first Passover that he's going to come to Jerusalem. Because when the Jewish Passover, which is recorded in the Gospel, the first one he came to, what did he do? He did exactly what Malachi 3 said he would do. He come in, want to clean the temple. Brothers and sisters, you can read it in the Gospel. When he came into Jerusalem on that first Passover, after he had been baptized, he made a whip, and he cleansed the temple of the money changers and everything. And from then on, brothers and sisters, 3 consecutive years, he ministered and he preached to the Jewish nation. Every time he came to Jerusalem, it was always trouble. So we established his ministry was 3.5 years. Now he was crucified in the Passover time, which is in the spring of the year. 3.5 added on to his 30 makes it 33 and a half years of age. So we can say he was cut off within the 34th year of his life. So then he was born somewhere back beyond that period right there. And that's the mystical part. That's why I say, brothers and sisters, to the oneness people that have taken the extreme side, if the birth of Jesus, the baby Jesus, if he was Jehovah, if it's important that we know his crucifixion, why wouldn't it be important then that we know his birth if he was born Jehovah? Now then, this is a solar calendar D. That ended this point right there. Now then, 7 times 7 is 49. 62 times 7 is 434. So that means from the beginning of this decree unto the crucifixion of Christ, there is going to be precisely, time-wise, 483 prophetic years of Bible time. I'm going to end it right there. And the next time, we're going to take this and break it down into days and show you how it all figures out, brothers and sisters. But Jesus Christ, he was definitely born before the death of King Herod. Because remember, Joseph and Mary had the baby Jesus in Egypt when the word came by the angel to Joseph. Behold, he who sought the young child's life is dead.
Amen.
Therefore, Joseph, taking Mary and his child, he starts back into the land of Israel. Heavenly Father, I pray this morning. Lord, I realize that many times all these words may seem as nothing. But help us, gracious Lord, to catch the glimpse, the purpose of these 69 weeks that have done been fulfilled. What happened? And how it was fulfilled precisely according to the prophecy. And if that was true, Lord, we know that the next week of time, that 7 years, that somewhere in front of us is definitely going to start. I pray that our spiritual souls can be ready, we can walk with you, and Father, be found as truly children of light, and you would be glorified. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.